Good morning, Ebenezer.
Good morning.
Another beautiful day, a great day to be in the dirt, in the church, and I'm getting excited about Easter, as I'm sure everybody is. Aren't we glad to be Easter people? We are so blessed to be in this church, and let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for so many things, but most of all, what we're about to celebrate in the next couple of weeks. Thank you beyond words, really. Take this opportunity today to change us a little bit more, make us more into your likeness. Open our hearts and minds to hear what you would have us hear. You know our hearts, you know our needs, and you never fail to meet us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture reading today is Psalm 130. God will surely forgive us if we confess our sins to Him. From the depths of despair, O Lord, I call for your help. Hear my cry, O Lord. Am I ahead of the game here a little bit?
That's okay. We can do two things at once.
Multitasking. Hear my cry, O Lord. Pay attention to my prayer. Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could ever survive? But you offer forgiveness, that we might learn to fear you. I am counting on the Lord, yes, I am counting on him. I have put my hope in his word. I long for the Lord, more than centuries long for the dawn. Yes, more than centuries long for the dawn. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is unfailing love. His redemption overflows. He himself will redeem Israel from every kind of sin. And now, Hymn of Praise, Were You There, page 288.
Thank you.
worship song, For God So Loved the World. With the love of Christ.
Thank you.
Join together with the Apostles' Creed, found on page 881 in your hymnal.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and stood at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Right, a couple of announcements. The altar flowers are given by Jenny Zelick in memory of her husband David, who went to be with our Lord and Savior March 22, 2003, after fighting a 4-year battle with lung cancer. We love and miss you so much and feel you with us in our hearts each and every day. A few other things. The church council meeting at 7 p.m. in the fellowship hall. Church cleanup day starting at 9 a.m. on Saturday. The contact number is in here. Make sure you look at all this calendar of events. There's a lot of good stuff. And then a very busy Holy Week, including the Monday, Thursday service and dinner. Good Friday events. The Easter egg hunt, by the way, volunteers are still needed for the Easter egg hunt. And wrapped candy for inside the plastic eggs. There are boxes strategically placed in the building someplace for you to donate candy, and we still need volunteers for the Easter egg hunt. I believe Mr. Eric has an announcement to make as well.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The SBR committee this week received a letter from the bishop and his cabinet announcing that Glenn has been reappointed this church for another year of service.
Well, I'm grateful for that. I'm glad. I hope most of y'all are too. It's been a great time. The last couple of weeks in church, the men's retreat a week ago was just phenomenal. When people asked what it was like, I said, you really can't do it justice other than when the Holy Spirit shows up somewhere, miracles happen.
Amen.
And it really was just an awesome blessing. We did this past week. Candy and I were visiting with Becca in Denver. We weren't here, but there was 24 hours of prayer in the sanctuary. And we certainly are blessed by the continued outpouring of prayer. We do have a number of things going on in the church coming up to Holy Week and the season of Lent. I would encourage you to be a part of that, whether that's the Monday, Thursday, or special Good Friday service we're going to do this year at 7 p.m. And then, Easter from sunrise and the other services. And, of course, every week we begin our week in here at 9 a.m. on Monday in prayer. So if you're available, I'd encourage you to come and join that group. If you can't and have a specific prayer concern, I'd ask you to write it down on a prayer card there in the pew, put it in the offering plate, and we will be faithful to pray over that. I would encourage you in the bulletin to look over all those names, all the families listed there, and to be faithful for all those people that the Lord has entrusted to us, that we'd be just in prayer with. Remind everybody, it's Communion Sunday. Any money left at the altar rail during Communion supports Beat the Drum Village. That's the orphanage in Africa that we support. They do wonderful work there. There's a few places where our money is better spent than supporting Beat the Drum Village, so I would encourage you to be a part of that ministry. And just to give thanks to the Lord for all that He has done. I say, even though we're coming up this Easter, the season of Lent, as believers, every day is Easter. Every day. Every day is Christmas when you're a believer. And certainly every day is Thanksgiving. There's never a more appropriate prayer we have than giving thanks to the Lord, despite whatever may be going on individually in our lives, is that sometimes our lives seem out of control. Matter of fact, a lot of times they do. God is on His throne, and He is fully in control. And for whatever reason, this mystery of prayer, He invites us to petition Him in prayer and to intercede on the behalf of others. And there's a few things we do that's a greater honor than that. And so for all the prayer concerns, all those names listed, we've had Mr. Holcomb passed away this past week. Mr. Holcomb is the gentleman who's owned this property over here and has farmed that garden for a long, long time. He's been a friend of this church, even though he didn't attend here. He's going to be greatly missed, not by just by his family and us, but just this community. Has been familiar with the gift that he had for gardening for so long. So we want to just pray for him and the family. It's great to see some of y'all here continue to recover and heal from recent surgeries. Great to have Rock back here with us. What other prayer concerns or Thanksgiving you want to raise up this morning? Just jump.
I got a couple of Thanksgiving. One, the Marine Matthew is engaged.
Awesome. Yes, David.
Yeah, prayer at Thanksgiving for Sandy's mom. Things were not looking very good, but she turned around and miraculously her heart is in rhythm for the first time in a long, long time. So she's got a long way to go, but we're thankful for that. And also, we saw my Viking buddy Ken last night, and Ken is doing a lot, lot better. We're thankful for that.
Excellent. And that reminds me as well is that Communion Sunday, if you notice, I get a lot of requests over how good our communion bread is. David McBrayer makes that every month. And it's a little special recipe. Yeah, very, very good. Yeah. And so people always want to know if they could have more communion bread.
It's unleavened, so.
Yeah.
It's a little flat.
No, it's very good. And it's just one of our little Ebenezer traditions that we want to carry on. So, with that in mind, let's have a moment of quiet reflection, meditation, as we prepare our hearts for prayer. Lord, in the serenity and the peace of this sanctuary, we gathered here, Lord, to hear from you, that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that you would guide us into all truth. Lord, that our hearts would be sensitive to the need around us. And Lord, we just continue to be grateful just for all that you have done. We thank you for Judy joining this group, this congregation, that we might be faithful to her as well in her walk with you. Lord, just for the good news for Sandy's mother, for Rock's healing, for Nanette, her continued healing from her shoulder, for Carm, and for all those who continue to deal with the loss of loved ones, because we know, Lord, nobody is really lost. They're just in your presence and until we are reunited again. And for the hope that we have in the gospel, the joy that you have given us, for the laughter that takes place in this sanctuary, Lord, we give you thanks. And in all things, that you would continue to order our steps, that we would desire to do your will, more so, Lord, than following our own instincts, our own desires, Lord, that we might submit to you in love. And through all things, that you might continue, Lord, in everything, to show mercy and grace and love, that we may be called children of the living God. So, Father, for every name listed in our bulletin, for all the unspoken concerns we have, Lord, it's our desire to lay them at the foot of your throne, and that we would remain focused, like-minded, a body of believers committed to your ministry. And Lord, so we just give you thanks for this day, this glorious day, that we would live fully in the moment and in all things. Lord, just continue to just reflect your glory. It's Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Will the ushers come forward to receive the offering, please?
Let's pray. Father God, you've given us so much. Please take this small portion of what you've given us and use it for the glory of your kingdom. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
together sing our hymn of preparation, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross, page 301.
That disappoints me about that is as sports fans, one of the things that unites a community, it doesn't really matter. Rich or poor, really doesn't matter what you do for a living, doesn't matter what you drive, that everybody would get together and we would be unified in June 14th. This is a wonderful little sense of democracy. But see, now I remember going through and visiting the luxury boxes when they built the Olympic Stadium, and I'm not a fan. The reason I'm not a fan is that, you know, somehow it's like, we're going to go to the ball game, we're going to be there, but I don't have to rub elbows with you. So I got my own little area, my own little chair, my own little bathroom thinking, that sort of defeats the purpose of us coming together as community. I'm also not a real big fan of these special lanes that you pay extra money in to get to somewhere faster. I don't like it. And the reason is, I mean, this is community project, isn't it? Like the roads that we use as, and all of a sudden now we create this separate tier. I'm used to this tiered system in everything else in the world. I know how that works. But some things in democracy, some things in the community, we're all to share those same things. So I think that's actually more of a loss. I remember years ago when Mickey Mantle developed had a bad liver, you know, probably for many years of drinking, and so they put him on the list to get new liver. And you know, if you need a transplant, you'll be on there for many years. I think Mickey Mantle's on there maybe 3.5 minutes. And they found a new liver for Mickey, and then there was this outcry. The outcry was, oh my gosh, he jumped ahead of the list. And I remember laughing, thinking, of course he jumped to the head of the list. He's Mickey Mantle. Of course he's not treated like the rest of us. People that are important, they have special access, right? One of the things I love about the church is these doors are wide open. We don't stop anybody from walking in here, do we? It's one of the few places, one of the few things is your status, you know, even your longevity, whatever. You walk in these doors and you put your hand up, you want to join, you have full rights, full access, right? You're not denied anything. I love that about the church. We didn't make that up. That comes directly from Jesus. Our scripture today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 11. I'm actually going to read verses 1 through 7 and then 17 through 45. It's a long passage. If you have your Bibles with you, I would encourage you to open those up now. And if not, there's a pew Bible ahead that you can follow along. Gospel of John, chapter 11. It says, now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When he heard this, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. Notice for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Then he said to his disciples, let's go back to Judea. Now, verse 17, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, well, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she told him, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor, for he'd been there 4 days. And Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me.
When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did put their faith in him. This is the good news of the gospel. This is the life-changing word of God for the people of God. There's so much going on in this story of the death of Lazarus, but I think the thing really stands out is Jesus knew that Lazarus, he said, was going to go to sleep. They said would be dead. Jesus knew he wasn't going to stay in that tomb, that he was going to raise him from the dead. And yet when Jesus comes and visits with Martha and Mary and explains, you know, just have faith and you'll get to see the glory of God. But with Mary weeping, the Jews around here weeping, it said he was deeply moved. And he wept. Now, he knew there was victory. It's just close. But we have a Lord who so empathizes with us. He so relates to us, is that he is moved by our grief. And I can admit, I'm not always that way. My first thought is when I heard about this horrible road collapse on I-85, you know what my first thought was? Man, I'm glad I'm not commuting there. You know, and unfortunately, that selfish reaction is a normal reaction. When you hear things that have gone wrong or somebody's struggling, you know, too often I'm thinking, wow, boy, I'm glad I avoided that. Didn't happen to me. That's not the response of Jesus. And he's so moved by the sorrow around him that he weeps. You know, I guess many times that we end up weeping or sad or sorry that something that has befallen us or something that we have struggled with, but Jesus not only putting skin on and walking among us and relating to us, but just thought that so living in the moment, not even thinking about just a little while from now, we're going to have this great victory and it's going to be this wonderful sign of God, but just living fully in the moment, the two things, his presence and his being available right then and there. And so often I think we miss out on what's happening right here and now with the people because maybe I'm thinking selfish thoughts, how things affect me, instead of having that empathy that the Lord has, so much so that he's moved by those around him, and he weeps. In Isaiah chapter 53, 700 years before the birth of Christ, the prophet was prophesying about this great king that was to come. And of course, the Jews were waiting on a King David who united the kingdom, defeated their enemies, great King David with power. You know what kings do? Kings, they get to ride in the pay lane. They don't have to pay. They sit in the luxury boxes. Right? The neat thing about being a king is they don't need Congress. Kings rule by fiat. You know what that means? Oh, what do I feel like today? I just write a law. Y'all do it. It doesn't matter if anybody agrees. When you're the king, you don't have to get your hands dirty in people's affairs. I mean, you know, it's when's the last time you heard of any politician showing up eating pancakes in Iowa? They're not. You know when they're going back there? Next election. You know why? Because they don't need to. And so they don't. Matter of fact, we pass laws in this country that don't affect our elected officials. They want us to follow those laws. They don't even follow their own laws. You know why? Because they don't have to. Because they have power and they have authority and they use it for their advantage, don't they? Well, of course they do. Not the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who even though he has the power to raise the dead again, he's so moved by the suffering and pain around him that he cries. He weeps. As a matter of fact, on Palm Sunday, which we celebrate next week when Jesus comes into Jerusalem and the crowds are just, you know, calling out in Hosanna in the name of the Lord, and blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and the religious leaders, the killjoys that they are, said, hey, tell those people to be quiet. Tell them to hush up. Tell your followers, Jesus, hush up. And Jesus says, if they are still, the stones themselves will cry out. And then right after this, Jesus, on seeing Jerusalem, you know what he does? He sees Jerusalem. he weeps. He weeps. He says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you killed the prophets. How I long to gather you like a hen gathers her chicks, but you would not listen. He grieves. He's not crying for himself. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords weeps for the loss and for the suffering that one he never willed, he did not cause, but for his children, for his loved ones that he longs to gather around. I listened to a pastor recently. This woman was talking about her, she had an older son who got horribly involved in drugs. And he went through counseling and went through, you know, various programs and still struggled and couldn't. And finally the counselor said, you know, you really can't allow him to stay in the home because you have younger children. And people, you know, become addicted to things. It's just, they're just not in their right mind. They have a hard time telling the truth. They have a hard time being honest and knew the danger. And so what they said is, you're gonna have to let him go. You're 17 years old. And she made a comment that they put his belongings in a backpack. They put that backpack on her 17-year-old son and said that her and her husband pushed him out the door and told him to go. And her comment was, she said, the wailing that I did, the crying that I did all night almost did not sound human. She didn't want to have to do that, but knowing the suffering that her son and what the pain, we can all sort of relate to that in a way. And our Lord certainly does. There's something about having a leader that will walk among us. Don't we so desire that? The great generals, they're not off remote. They're not sitting far in the distance ordering their troops around. The great generals are eating the same food as their troops, and they're staying with their troops. And what happens? Troops love those generals. You know why? It's like one of us. He has the authority to elevate himself and sit in a special spot and take privileges, but instead, he decides to be with us. The kind of leadership that we all want to embrace, that we all want to see, and just don't see it very much, do we? That's the difference between earthly leadership and godly leadership. We have a King of Kings and a Lord of Lords who so relates and empathizes with us and so lives in the moment that he weeps. In 1979, in March, had the greatest nuclear accident in the history of this country. It's Three Mile Island, and it was a series of events that went wrong. There was a valve stuck open, there was a release of water, and these alarms go off, and the workers mistakenly thought there was too much water, cooling system, so they let more water out, and then more alarms went off, and this great panic went up, and radioactive steam clouds went up, and it was across the nation now. There was this great panic. And they didn't know how bad it was, and I really felt for the people trying to explain this because they didn't fully understand it, and now there's a panic in Pennsylvania that took place. This was 12 days after the movie China Syndrome came out, which was very similar in a lot of ways. And so the spokesmen are trying to explain. The truth is they didn't know what was going on, but how do you stand in front of a nation and say, are we in trouble? Well, man, I don't know. So they were stuck, so they're trying to do the best they can, and while they weren't being fully open about it, it just made things worse. You have the governor of the state, and he didn't know what they're doing. They're calling, do we do evacuation? So finally, they're going back and forth. They didn't want to set off a panic, and so the governor, they had a limited evacuation. They said, well, if you happen to be pregnant, you got a young child, you better get out of here. Now, how does that make you feel if you're left behind? As a matter of fact, even the government officials, people in charge, they were concerned about their own health and well-being and their families. So then after a couple of days and the situation wasn't getting better, it seemed like it was getting worse. You had people from the federal government came in trying to help. And once again, you know, it was just, what do we do next? And it was a hydrogen bubble that got into the containment building that all they knew is half these experts said this thing could blow up at any time. And if it blew up, we're in trouble because coincidentally in the movie China Syndrome, it gave the example if there was a core meltdown. And what they refer to is that core so overheats, that uranium, it gets so hot, it melts right through the bottom of the building, right through the concrete, right through the ground, and it'll keep going down until it hits groundwater. And when it does, it will explode, and that steam will come up through anything above it. Gravel, parking lot, concrete, whatever. And in the movie, made a comment that this could wipe out This could cause long-term devastation in an area as large as the state of Pennsylvania, which coincidentally, that's where Three Mile Island was. So the governor was at odds, and the federal officials were at odds, but one leader intervened. The president of the United States was Jimmy Carter. He's a nuclear scientist, and he was aware of this quantity. He was aware of half these experts that said this thing could blow up at any time. You know, they said, we don't think this hydrogen bubble is that severe a threat. And with this great uncertainty, he did something that a lot of his advisors didn't want him to do. He went to Pennsylvania. And he went to Three Mile Island, and he put on covering on his feet because everything there was contaminated, and the water in the bottom of the tenbill was contaminated. And as he was driving through, as he was in his limousine, and he was escorted there, says the people that were left behind there, they saw the President of the United States, and they all applauded because he had not abandoned them. And when he showed up and he did that, and he toured that facility, now, the danger was not necessarily over, but everything then had changed. The atmosphere, the mood, everything, the panic, the hysteria had changed because our leader was with us. Now, whether or not you're a big fan of Jimmy Carter or not, that was about his finest moment. And by the way, they found out later, much later, about half that nuclear core had melted down, about half of them. They were in severe danger. But don't we long for a leader like that who doesn't make themselves aloof, make themselves separate, it's the haves and the have-nots, but we have a Lord. In Isaiah 53, as was prophesied 700 years before Christ, verse 3, that he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. And yet, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who has all authority and all power, didn't use it for his own benefit, but so related to us and so empathized with us that he weeps. That he weeps. Romans chapter 12, in verses 9 through 15, is the Apostle Paul writing. Explain how we're supposed to deal with one another. In principle, as you know, being a disciple just means being a follower. You know, it sounds like a theological term, what it means to be a disciple. It doesn't mean that we sit there studying all day. Just being a disciple means that we're a student, we're a follower. And Jesus doesn't do anything, or he doesn't call us to do anything, he doesn't do himself. You know, how many times, you know, whether it's a teacher, a coach, or a parent, you never like hearing from somebody, do what I say, don't do what I do. I mean, nobody likes that, right? Jesus says, follow me, watch me, learn from me, yoke yourself with me. He's considered a man of sorrows. So in Romans 12, 9 through 15, Apostle Paul said, love must be sincere, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, honor one another above yourselves, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. That's what it is. It's showing up. It's showing up. Jimmy Carter showed up. He did an awesome thing. He didn't have to. Jesus Christ showed up. What's fascinating is, and here's the, now, when Jesus heard about Lazarus being sick, how long did he wait to go? 2 days. Waited 2 days. Now, everybody's thinking, let's get moving. You know, and both Martha and Mary said, if he'd have been here, he hadn't have died. We don't like the Lord's timing, do we? We're not a big fan of the time. It's like, Lord, show up. You know, the Lord says, it's all okay. Oh, no, he's sick. He's sleeping. Okay, well, if he's sleeping, Lord, if he's sleeping, he'll be good. No, he's dead. He's dead, but he's not going to stay there. We just have faith and understand that the Lord never leaves us, and now he tells us to have the same relationship with each other. So those two things we're called to do. One is to show up. The thing is, when people have good news, now let me ask you, if something really good happened to you, you know, or something happened really great to one of your children, and you were blessed some way, how many people, if you told, would either think you were bragging or they'd be jealous of you, didn't want to hear it? And how many people, if you said, I had this great thing happen, would they rejoice with you and be sincere about it? Those are the people who truly love us. I'll never forget, it's made a big impression on me is after Becca hadn't been born yet, and we lived in a home for a while, and then we decided to build a home that, you know, we drew the plans out. This was kind of like a dream home for us, and so we had it built, and it took like 6 months or so, and we were very grateful and happy. Well, my closest, dearest friend, when he came with his wife and visited, he was just beaming. He was just beaming. And I remember telling his brother, oh, man, you'll see the home that Glenn and Kenny. And what cracked me up is, at that time, they were a little more modest home. They could have purchased a home three times the size of the one we had. And they were still a little modest home. And he was gushing. He was bragging about the home. I'm thinking, he's rejoicing. He's grateful. He's happy. That's a true friend, is that we rejoice with those who rejoice. And then, with those who mourn, we don't avoid. We mourn. And you know why we do that? Because that's what Jesus does. It's his presence in the moment. In the moment. The one thinking, let's just hold on. We're going to raise the dead here in five more minutes. Right here and now, we're weeping together. Because you know what? It all turns out good in the end. As a matter of fact, the promise is that, you know, Jesus describes death. Paul describes death. It's an enemy. Death is an enemy that's defeated. By the way, we're promised. 21st chapter of Revelation. Revelation 21, verses 1 through 4. And it's not cheating to read to the end of the book. You can always go back and fill in the parts, but it is really good to know how it turns out. Just like they should have known what was going to happen with Lazarus when Jesus said he's not going to stay there. But in Revelation 21, it says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, the first heaven and the first earth. Now, do y'all realize heaven is going to pass away? That heaven exists now, doesn't stay? It says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And by the way, Jerusalem is described through Scripture as a harlot, unfaithful, as a prostitute, right? See, if you've been married eight times and you've had six other boyfriends, you don't get to wear white again unless the Lord puts his hands on you. If the Lord puts his hands on you and you're perfected, you know what? You wear white again, and the holy city Jerusalem has been so unfaithful, like a harlot, now has been purified by the Lord. So it says on that day, like a beautiful bride dressed for her husband, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. He will wipe every... Y'all still got some tears? Well, that's okay, because it's a time for mourning. That's what these flowers represent, loss. They represent mourning. Everybody here has suffered some loss, and it's a time for tears. But it won't always be a time for tears, because the Lord himself will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who is seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Is that a good promise or what? Everything. Praise be to God. Until then, we mourn, but we also show up. The power in the presence and living in the moment, forgetting what was behind because it's gone, not worrying about the future because it belongs to the Lord. We live fully in the moment and rejoice and mourn and wait with patience. But until then, we have His very real presence. Let us pray. Lord, we thank You that You're a leader, that You're a God who humbled Himself to walk among us, and not only that, but to feel our pain, to feel our suffering, and to be immersed in it because You chose to. Lord, may we carry each other's burdens as You lift ours, that we may be called children of the living God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. There is no better way that we celebrate Christ's real presence, and we acknowledge His real presence in communion. In this season, as we near the Passover celebration and the remembrance of that Last Supper, that when Jesus met with His friends, His disciples in the upper room, that day He gave thanks and He took the bread and He broke it and He gave it to His disciples and He said, "Take and eat. This is My body, which is given for you." And after the supper was ended, He took the cup again, giving thanks to the Father. He gave the cup to His disciples and He said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is My blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." And Lord, we give You thanks for what You have done for us. And we would ask, Lord, that You would consecrate this bread and this juice. Lord, we ask that You would transform this bread and this juice, that we would acknowledge Your real presence, that this would become the body and blood of Christ, that we may be the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by His blood. Amen. I'd like to ask those who are assisting with communion to come forward. Remind everyone that in the United Methodist Church, this communion table is open to all because this table does not belong to the United Methodist Church. This table does not belong to Ebenezer. This is the Lord's table. And the Lord has invited you to His table to participate in His body and blood. I would ask you to come forward. We'll receive by intention, which means we'll tear off a piece of the communion bread. And then you will dip it in the cup. If you'd like to spend a minute at the altar, you're welcome to do so. I'll remind you, anything left here at the altar, we'll go to Beat the Drum Village. The table has been prepared. Come as you would. Thank you.
Invitation is page 462, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Y'all come up here and greet our newest member.